mental integrity, empowering, and her individual intuitive approach created an atmosphere of finding one's voice. The performance programs tonight will be a testament to an unfettered and spontaneous legacy of composing, as well as presenting their own highly individual musical voices. Their short sets will include a number of jazz lines Connie composed. Tonight is also a very special concert because it will include the remarks and poem written for Connie in 2016 by her dear friend and ours, poet Steve Dalachinsky, who passed away suddenly just 11 days ago and would have been here to read it himself. If I can, he told me. His beautiful remarks are included in the written program and we will read them after intermission. As Andrea Wolper said about Connie at Edge Fest 3 years ago, we were so fortunate to have Connie in our lives. What a miracle that someone like her ever existed. We know the very same could be said about Steve. The program, 3 short 20-minute sets, 10-minute intermission, CDs for sale, restrooms in basement, then 3 more 20-minute sets, followed by a short Q&A with the artists. Please remember to turn your phones off, and please keep your program and refer to your written programs for more detailed information about the artist on this program and more about Connie. Thank you.
Thank you all for being here. Thank you guys so much for coming. Connie's lines are also beautiful.
get into it, but it's based on a song called What Is This Thing Called Love? And, you know, it's a really good question, and I know we all search for answers, and we all have different answers. I think Connie really knew what love was, and Connie, you know, shared with all of us.
Thank you. Before we start our set, I just want to take a moment to acknowledge our producer, this evening's producer, Abby London-Crawford. Abby is a true patron of the arts, and she shows us that you don't have to be a Medici or a Koch brother. You don't have to be a millionaire or a gazillionaire to support art and artists. You just need the kind of love and inspiration and commitment and energy that she embodies so powerfully, and she deserves more acknowledgement than those few words. But again, Abby London-Crawford, where are you? So, as you may have read in the program, and as you've noticed so far, there's sort of an emphasis tonight on compositions of Connie's, but I am instead focusing on Connie's words. Everyone who knew her knows that she spoke about music and life and food and politics and all kinds of things with truth and passion and great wisdom. And so for this first piece, I took some text, a sort of poem that she sang, I believe improvised, and on an early recording, and I wrote a musical setting for those words. I did this, Abby, in her introductory notes, mentioned that there was back in November 2016, there was an event, and it was first presented there. It's been with different instrumentation every time because I wrote it originally for voice, double bass, and clarinet. And I'm thrilled that Virg Dzurinko and Claire Brunner have joined me and took my chart written for double bass and clarinet and made it their own.
Thank you.
So I have some nerve. But this next short piece is something that I just wrote for this evening. And as of the last piece, I took some words of Connie's and treated them as lyrics. So actually, this is the first time I've played piano in front of people. So I'm really not being, it's not false modesty when I say I'm not a pianist. But I'm going to do my best. And I'm going to ask you to, well, you won't know when I play wrong notes, because you won't know the piece. Although I did borrow little bits and phrases from other pieces of Connie's, including the one you just heard played by Claire and Mara. So I'm going to ask you to just try to ignore the inevitable errors and pretend they're intentional and just focus on Connie's wise, beautiful words. This is When We Create Music.
Thank you.
like I said, was scheduled to be on this program, and he was scheduled to read the poem that he wrote. I decided, and he said simply, you know, like as I said previously, I'll be there if I can. And I spoke with Yuko, and she was very, very pleased that we were going to do his words tonight. I'll first read the memorial speech, but then you're welcome to join me. Steve had a rhythm that he sometimes didn't take a breath. I don't know if I can do that that way, but you're welcome to join me on the poem. It's in your program. And I printed it exactly how Steve sent it to me, because his punctuation. I first encountered Connie through her music when one day on KCR I heard some incredible stuff. The DJ said afterward that it was Connie Crothers and Max Roach. I had no internet, no computer, and I couldn't find the CD. At the time, I was a guest on a radio show in Canada. They called me in New York. I talked about what was happening around town. I made an announcement that if anyone knew where to find the CD, get one for me and I'll pay them back. Lo and behold, at the next Vision Festival, this wonderful guy from Canada who came every year came up to me and handed it to me, and when I offered to pay him, he said it was a gift. Wow. The kind of guy Connie would love. Was I ever pleased? Well, soon after, on a trip to Paris, I walked into a thrift shop that had a few LPs sitting on the floor, and there among Coltrane and Papa Joe was the Connie Crothers trio on Steeplechase. I found out later it was her first recording. I looked at Yuko and my two young friends and said, she's a woman. And a beautiful woman at that. I immediately fell in love. Soon after, at another Vision Fest, I got to hear Connie live for the first time with Jamil and asked her to sign the record, which she graciously did. I began to follow her concerts, and soon we became friends and then collaborators. I can't say much more except that she was the realest, fairest person I possibly have ever met, and she accepted you as you were. Well, she accepted me anyway, and that's no easy task. What will always haunt me is that a few days before she passed, she called me after several emails back and forth with you and me explaining she really couldn't talk much. Her message was simple and very Connie. Steve, we have to talk. I'll try your cell phone. I don't think she ever did. And for the rest of my life, I'll always wonder what it was she wanted to tell me. She recorded our gig together in her loft with an audience of three and always wanted to put it out. I stupidly kept procrastinating, and the last thing we talked about was that. I have it somewhere, and one day, hope to fulfill her wish. Jay Clayton said recently that Connie lived her dream, and so too did she dream her life. A life of justice, love, peace, harmony, and above all, genuine friendship. Ed Schuller said Connie always played all the things you are, and when he asked why, she basically replied that it had everything and that one could always extract different feelings from it every time one played it. Recently, I met a student of hers, and as we got to talking, I asked him to name one thing he distinctly took away from her teachings. He said she told him to play, you got it, all the things you are, a lot for that same reason, to make it new every time is how I like to think of it. Here is a poem, a kind of love poem. I wrote for her when we visited her in the hospital that last day, and she was no longer able to, you know. All the things you are not, and have yet to become. It's a heat wave. Even the trees offer no asylum, as death lingers behind the curtains of your room, filled with those you love and who love you. In the empty waiting room close by, a small piano awaits your touch, frantic, sedate. Touch, the only thing that keeps this sad boy inside me sane. In the empty waiting room filled with empty chairs, I wait for you to enter and empty your feelings into that small, sad piano that
that I know you probably say was not fit for playing bad piano, I'm thinking, but maybe not so bad, just kind of lonely. I compose a poem on it, pretending I am a composer, as the windows fill with light and the flowers bud, birds and butterflies on the otherwise empty walls quiver, releasing their secrets, and the earth stands still as we aliens wait for the curtains to part. The empty chairs face all directions. Two armchairs face each other deep in conversation. Who's been here? And what have you heard about so-and-so lately? A small sign says, please do not move the furniture around. Perfectly centered on an 8.5 by 11 sheet of white paper. The light decreases as the clouds gather. Ken says Lucifer means light, the other side of the coin. Not necessarily a bad thing. Ken, with his devilish eyebrows always pointing upward. The piano plays for itself inside my head, where a golden dome as fiery, as lovely as your orange hair beckons us to enter. You sit at the piano, bend your head low, your lovely fingers stretched toward the keyboard. I whisper from behind, play, piano player, play. And you do. And all the things you are, all the things we all are, inside and out, respond to your touch. Thank you, Steve.
Version of Melancholy Baby. Thank you.
Come to me, my melancholy babe.
Bye. 32-bar blues waltz, and it's called Keep Friendship. And I noticed that when Abby read Steve's remarks, he mentioned Connie's, people were really important to Connie, and if she liked you, she was all in. And it, deep friendship, it's almost, in a way, more than love. I can't explain it, but the feeling is people don't talk about friendship as much as they talk about love. So Connie talks about friendship in this line. And we have a little intro that we're gonna do, and then take a breath, and then go on.
Thank you. So Connie had a real deep soul connection with Emily Dickinson. And Connie was also a poet. And Emily Dickinson was also a piano player. She used to improvise at night on her piano. One soul, two incarnations, possibly. Anyway, this idea landed in my head one day to put them together, to set Emily's words to Connie's lines. I just feel like they're collaborating with me because I couldn't have done this. To choose the poems to go with the lines. It's just extraordinary how it just started happening. So I'm in the midst of this project, and part of why I want to do this is so that I can create this for singers, to have a way to sing Emily to Connie's lines. So I'm going to do a couple of them tonight. Connie's line on There'll Never Be Another You is called Prez Says for Lester Young. And her line on Getting Sentimental Over You is called Roy's Joy for Roy Eldridge. And in the middle of them, I'm going to play Max Roach, which is a piece that Connie played at a concert in, I believe it was 78 or 79. I was there. And she based this on a series of 5-4 patterns in the left hand. And so it was alternating those patterns with a bass line. So I'm going to do my own expression, hopefully. It's a magnificent piece. So I'm going to, when I do the poems, I'm going to speak them first. Can you hear my words? Okay. I'm seated. I'm no longer theirs. The name they dropped upon my face with water in the country church is finished using now. And they can put it with my dolls, my childhood, and the string of spools I've finished threading too. Baptized before, without the choice, but this time, consciously of grace, unto supremest name. Call to my full existence's whole arc, filled up with one small diadem. My second rank, too small the first, crowing on my father's breast, a half-unconscious queen. But this time, adequate, erect, with will to choose or to reject, and I choose just a crown. Stopping this, the name they dropped. when it is found, a few rejoice, the wise convey it home. Carefully cherishing the spot, if other flower become. When it is lost, that day shall be the funeral of God. Upon his breast, a closing soul, the flower of our Lord. There was a solitude of space, a solitude of sea, a solitude of death. But these society shall be, compared with that profounder sight, that polar privacy. A soul admitted to itself, finite, infinity. This is a blossom of the brain, a small italic sea left by my happening.
What an exquisite program. Thank you.
Thank you so much. I think the music speaks for itself. I'm going to forego the Q&A that I thought was necessary. But if you read in the program, you'll know how I asked each artist to give a little bit of a quote about Connie, and they came up with some wonderful, wonderful insights into what Connie meant to them. So please take your program and read it. It's really a treasure. But I also want to invite anybody in the audience who, I know there are a few people out there who are very close to Connie also and came from far away, like Mark Weber. If I don't want to put you on the spot, if you would like to say some words, I would like to open it up to anybody else who, you know. Mark, would you come up? Would you like to say something?
I was talking to Connie on the telephone. She used to like to call me a jammer about literature. But one time I was like, that was like really deep off into deadlines. And I was like, I said, tell your students, be careful what they hope for. You might get it. You know, I've actually in my whole life been cheated. Successful with writing, and she goes, no, I don't want to be careful. Tell them to be careful with this. No, this is pure comedy. I can get it right. She goes, what's the line?
Speak the mic.
Start. I'm forgetting the line. She goes, no. I say, be careful what you hope for, and she said. Anticipate what you hope for. Thank you, Nick. I wrote that down somewhere, so I think I remember another thing, real quick. I was bellyaching about one thing or another. I said, God, there's some problem here with this and that. And she goes, no, Mark, as long as it's real.
Wonderful duos headed by Luis Simas of Brazil, Armin Danilian, and Steve Stanberg. So I welcome you to see that as well. Anybody else would like to make any comments? Or again, the music spoke deeply to me, and I thank you again for sharing your artistry. And your love for Connie tonight. So it's been a pleasure. Thank you so much.